Hello. So my name is Jean-Yves. I work for the Desjardins Group, which is the largest credit union in Canada. So we have approximately 45,000 employees in Canada and business assets of $275 billion. So we're mainly in the banking industry, but also insurance and mortgage and brokers. So we do a lot of things, mainly in the province of Quebec, but also in Ontario. We have, in Ontario, it's going to be much more the insurance stuff that we are, it's going to be there. We bought the State Farm Canadian counterpart 2 years ago, so that has helped us grow a little bit bigger since then. So I'm the senior advisor for our CTI team. Even though we're a big company, we're only three in my team, including me. So we don't work 35 hours a week. It's much more than that. But I consider myself not a workaholic, but I love what I do. It's a passion. So I don't bother making hours each and every day. So I would say not my main question, but what drives me, say, was it easier to be in the security fields 5 years ago? 5 years ago, from my point of view, it was easier to do security because I would say that the security news were, I wouldn't say obscure, but not really in the news. So when something was happening, I don't know, 5,000 miles away from Canada, we were lucky enough that our executive were not aware of those security issues, so they didn't ask any question to us. So we were okay to do the correction and to be able to mitigate any issue that could happen to Desjardins. So this image, to my point of view, is funny because now security is getting to the board. Desjardins is also on the same boat, I would say, because it's now considered a risk for Desjardins. There is 9 risks that are the top most one, and the security is the third one, the third most important one. So I would say approximately 5 years ago, there was a lot of security breaches and act that were publicized. Those examples are from the Information is Beautiful website, so you can go there. And 2018, it's more than a double, and they're getting bigger and bigger, and it's not always the same kind of company that get hacked. So any kind of company can get hacked. So that's the main driver for us, because with the economy that has changed, everything is going to the cloud. So the cloud is marvelous, but it can also gives us a lot of pain to live with this new way of doing business. So here's a few examples that we have worked on in the last few years. Those are the main ones, but there's hundreds of them. But you recognize all the logo or whatever the website that is associated with it. So all the cloud of Amazon, CloudBleed, other friend fighter, Ashley Madison. Even though it sounds funny for a bank, some people register their names, their real name and their real email address, business address, to those websites. So that's the kind of stuff that we try to monitor also to us to do the assessment. Is there an impact on Desjardins, on us, on our reputation? Equifax, we're a bank, so Equifax, we're directly targeted. WannaCry, Swift, we're part of Swift also. And the last one is British Airways. It might sound funny, but we were impacted with the breach that they had a couple of months ago, because with the Mage card, what we have done, when we do our daily monitoring, one of the things that we do is we take security news and we try to remove when you take a cake, you remove everything that's on the cover, and you say, oh, what's underneath? What is the modus? Is this a technology that we own? Do we do business with this company? In this kind of situation, they were credit card. So we were able to find the credit cards that belongs to our employees, but also to our clients. So we did a mitigation, and this scenario, sorry, one of the library that was used was currently used on some of our websites. So after with this kind of information, we contacted the IT team and told them, you need to do a correction just to be sure that we will not yet act like British Airways. again, 5 years ago, I think we were lucky enough because all the ownership of the IT stuff were under our umbrella. But now, everything, not everything, but a lot of stuff is in the cloud. Whatever the cloud, can be Amazon, Azure, whatever. And in our case, Desjardins has 45,000 employees and many subsidiaries, and those subsidiaries are independent. So they are allowed to host things outside of our infrastructure. So if they want a website, they can ask a marketing team outside of the company to do the development and to do the hosting for them. So for us, it's a lot of risk because we don't control the IT. We need to control our own cloud, but we need to control third party that can have access to our own company. Like Target a few years ago, it was not Target that was targeted, but they act a third party company that have access to Desjardins. So that Desjardins to Target, sorry. So we need to be able to follow everything that can happen. So that's why we don't work 35 hours a week. So executive wants to know, as us, they have cell phone, they have access to a lot of information, and the information goes very quickly between partners. So we have friends on the CTI stuff, but as executive, they have friends also, so they share information between them. So you better know the information before them, because when they ask information they wanted for yesterday, they want to have the assessment, what are we doing. So that's what I'm going to show you in the next few slides, what we have done to be able to get them happy and keep us working for them. Our task, it is a few steps that we do each and every day, and I would say 7 days a week. So it's the source, the method, the analysis, what is actionable, and the communication. I've mentioned that we are three in my team, and we are three, but we don't come from the IT normal pattern, I would say. One of the person who works with me, because we're a team, but I'm the leader, but we consider ourselves as one person. She's a psychologist, and she came from the fraud department 3 years ago, and the other person is an engineer. So at first, we were not security specialists. So I would say it's odd. I'm the only one who did come back to school, because at first I was supposed to be an accountant. So it was accountant or marketing. So I hadn't decided at that time, but finally I came back to school and I decided to do something in technology, but it was not into security. So we have three different persons with three different personality. So it's really interesting to have the interaction with these people. We think differently than normal people. I think we're weird, but that's us. So at first, there's a lot of information on the internet. You can get submerged with everything. Like when you go on YouTube, you check one video, but at the end you check completely something different that you were at first supposed to check. So we have defined PIR, so priority intelligence requirements. So the definition that we have is the question that allows threat intelligent personnel to focus on what is important to the operator and management. It's very large. As mentioned, we're banking. We're in the banking industry, but also insurance. So we need to see everything. And we are also a card issuer. So we need to follow the PCI rules. So our daily monitoring covers the news about the new PCI requirements, Swift stuff, new TLS that's going to come probably in the next year. So we need to focus on a very large broad of things. And after that, to communicate this information, because we know that many different teams into Desjardins don't have the time to do the daily scrubbing of the internet or whatever. So we try to be their intelligence and to be their information unit. So we find the information, we try to do the short analysis, and after that, to contact the team that is responsible to do the modification. So I'm going to go into greater details on each one, but the sources, so open source intelligence, human intelligence, We have a lot of friends and peers that we talk to, digital footprint and scanners. After that, the methods, so the automatization tip that we use at Desjardins, threat intelligence platform, the analysis with the inventory and the tools that we use. After that, we try to have it actionable, because with the amount of data that we have metrics, yes, metrics on the CTI. So we were able to see from 2015, approximately, the data that we have more and more data each and every year. So at each data that we find, we try to communicate it. So, and we try to have an action on it and to be able to see this action, where was this reliable or not. And after that, the communication. So we have alerts, a portal, and a mobile apps for executives. So they don't ask us questions or text us. So they can be they can do whatever they want, whenever they want. So we don't get called on a Friday night. So our sources. So for sure, mainly, is the CMDB, so the Configuration Management Database. We're part of the SOC, so the Security Operations Center. The Security Operations Center involves the vulnerability team, so all the scanners are on their umbrella, so they scan everything. All the domain ownership, so we manage roughly 2,500 domains. So there's a lot of external hosting, SSL, whatever the technology that we can have. We have also the monitoring team. So every alert that goes out from the SIM, they are processed with a triage team, level 1, 2, 3. And we have also a threat hunting team, a dedicated team. So with the CMDB, when we have information, we have access to CMDB. Our CTI team, we try to have access to everything, at least in read mode. Even though sometimes it's frustrating for a certain team because they don't want us to have access, they challenge us, but our way of getting access is funny is to prove them that, I wouldn't say that they are wrong, but we ask them reports each and every week. Reports, can you have the reports? We know that they have the information, but they don't want to provide us the information. So we ask. And normally, 2 months after, they say, okay, here's the access. So we're able to see whatever we want. So when we see a piece of information on the internet, we can connect with the CMDB and check by ourselves, do we have the data? We're currently trying to build the buzzword data lake. So it's gonna be eventually accessible for us also. So hopefully, but for now we need to connect to different systems. But when we don't have the information and we're not sure, we open a ticket to the VM team. Also projects, might sound funny, but there's a lot of information that you can find there. We have access to the project department, so they manage all the projects that are launched into Desjardins because they manage a budget, so for sure you need to talk to them. So we're able to get the list of the project of, for example, 2019. So what we do, simple. We take the list of projects, we check the title, the description, and we try to find any technology that we're not aware of. So if there's a new technology that we're not aware of, for sure we're gonna add it to our day-to-day monitoring of this on the internet if there's a hack or a breach or whatever about this technology. But when there's something, projects sometimes forget to talk to security. So when something like that happens, we contact the project and ask them, have you involved any security personnel? Sometimes the answer is no, but when it's no, we challenge them and say, hey, you didn't follow the rules. You need to involve us because we need to check your infrastructure. And one of the main issues when they do projects, for sure we miss projects, but when there's an incident, they call us in panic and want us to correct any issue that could have happened. But we help them for sure, but they serve as an example to others. So it's funny when you ask a project to sign the bottom line and say, do you assume the risk? Most of the time they don't want to assume the risk because I don't know, they want to keep their job, I don't know. So projects, if you have access to the list of projects, consider that you should take a look in this direction. Also, open source intelligence. Even though we're a big company, CTI, I think we're good, but it's hard to justify to do expense for us, because the information that we have access or that we need sometimes are costly. If you have different CTI vendor, for example, it can be costly, slow. Sometimes it's different. It's difficult to have this justification. So we rely a lot on the open source intelligence, and I think we're lucky enough to find everything that we need. Twitter is an amount incredible of data that you can find there. I run my own Twitter account, so my day-to-day is to check Twitter. So the other people at work there told me that I only chill on the internet, but to their point of view, but it's not the only thing that I do. But when I see things, because I'm the main person who do the Twitter monitoring, I have a mailing list, so an internal mailing list, but also external person that I notify of this information that I have found. And there is roughly 300 persons, so it's not only person from the Desjardins. There's other banks in Canada, other person around the world. So that's my friends, and those friends are very, very helpful, and I'm going to talk about them a little bit later. So I have my mailing list, but I subscribe to mailing list, so I receive more than, I think last year it was more than 50,000 emails. So I don't read each and every one for sure, but I can. You can see trends. You can see that something is different, or when someone that you know or you trust send you an email, I think you should take a look at it. We have also subscription. So all the free stuff, abuse.ch, showdown, whatever, there's a lot of them. And in a lot of them, you can add keywords. You can receive alerts. So it's going to do the job for yourself. You don't need to be on a day-to-day monitoring to those stuff. DFIR, Digital Forensic and Incident Response. There's a website. There's quite a few websites that are available on the internet, and those are very, very, very important, because there's a lot of information. I can send, if you can connect with me on Twitter and can send you the links. But there's a lot of information that you can find there, and most of the time it's free stuff. So depending on what you have to do, sometimes it can be useful to check those websites, because if you have a question, probably someone already had this question and got the answer for you. So before looking by yourself, just check. UMINT, various sectors. In this section, it's connected to the project. What I do, I talk a lot, I know, but I know a lot of people at Desjardins, and I drink coffee and I drink beer. So the way of making friends, pay coffee and drink beer. And I know a lot of people. I know the person on the IT side, but I know also the manager and their secretary. Those are the best person that you can know. Because when you want an appointment with a manager, the agenda is already full. But when you know the secretary, you can call her and say, hey, can you help me? Can you find me a 15 minutes time slot? And normally they are able to do something for you. And you need to talk about it a little bit later, but you need to know what are their own objective. As a person, you have an objective that your boss has given you, but they have also objective. So when you're able to know their objective, you can know in which direction you should go. So it's going to be aligned with your PRR the first time. The peers. So we are as a financial institution, we are part of the CBA, so Canadian Banker Association. So we are also a part of the ISAC, so FS ISAC, Information Sharing and Analysis Center, also CCTX in Canada, and governments. There's a lot of initiative in Canada. I know that you have a lot also in the US and around the world. So talk to your CERT. In the US, you have the US CERT, but in Europe, there's a lot also in Japan. So there's a lot of CERT that they produce great documentation, and they share information between them. So if you're, I would suggest to go there, because by yourself, you cannot find anything on the internet, but those groups can help you a lot. Digital footprint and scanners. So VRM, so vendor risk management, is it's like a security score that companies can external company can give you based on the asset that they found on the internet on you. So I can name like a BitSight. I know that's one of the company. And DRM, digital risk management. So they, you have company like Risk IQ, so they go a little bit further. So that's the kind of company that you can buy from them. In this situation, you have no choice to have money, but at least you can have a better understanding on how the people can see your company from the outside. You have also scanners. We have many different web scanners. Some of them we paid for some, but for others, there's free stuff on the internet. So as long as you are allowed to scan your infrastructure, I would suggest to have those kind of scanners. And at the end, paid thread in Intel feeds. So there's a lot on the that you can find on the internet again. So you have a Cisco Flashpoint and whatever the threat Intel feed that you can find. But it depends what you're looking for, because some threat Intel feeds will only give you IOCs. So IOCs and domains, but there's millions of them. But sometimes the threat that you need is about actors and a new way of hacking a company. So it depends what is the kind of information that you need. The method, like I've mentioned, we are only three, so we cannot do everything. And we have some tools, some paid tools, but the vast majority is Python script. So you need to have a great developer or someone that can help you. There is a lot of free stuff on GitHub, so I would suggest to go there. For example, one of the script, it's monitor Twitter, but when we find certain keywords or certain person that posts something, we receive an alert, so we can inject directly into our threat intelligence platform. At Desjardins, we use Anomaly. I know that they are down there, but there's a lot of company. I think there's 20 company that can do this job. So they can do the aggregation, the single repo for your SIM, and you can share with your peers, because before the acquisition of the tip, everything was done manually. So at that time, we had access to our SIM, and it was a manual import of all the IUC that we were finding on the internet, so it was awful. But with a tip now, it's automatically injected into our SIM. Analysis. So with all the source and the information that we have, we have a lot of information, but we need to be able to do the connection between the two information. So we have access, like I mentioned, to CMDB. So we have the assets, we have the access to the scans, and we have access to the project. So we need to do a good recipe to be able to find, yes, there's a piece of information, we have the technology, but are we at risk? What is the exposure that we have currently? Is there a risk for our reputation to get hacked or to get robbed, or whatever the risk that we can have? And sometimes their news, when there's a website, a new logo, so the hype gets bigger. For example, I don't want to name probably there's someone in the room, but sometimes they when there's a website and a logo, it's a panic. So we need to do everything and stop everything else to focus only on this problem. But with the inventory, you need to be able to have access to this information, but like you need to have it in your head. So when you read something, you know it, you feel it. So it sounds funny, but that's the kind of stuff that we do. Like I mentioned also, the CMDB, domain monitoring. We own 2,500 domains at Desjardins, and we try to monitor also all the creation of domains using our brand, because we have an online banking platform. So fraudsters are incredibly good. So since 2015, we have more than we receive approximately 150,000 emails from our clients that they submit samples of phishing. So fraudsters are very aggressive against Desjardins and the banking industry in Canada in general. But last month we closed more than 700 websites, so it's a lot of websites to monitor, but on the other side, to monitor to close, but we need to monitor them. And there's threat actor that we were used to monitor or to follow, but with the GDPR last year, it was not a big help for us, because I know that the Whois information can be bogus, but some fraudsters are not very brilliant, I would say. So they were easy to follow because they were always using the same pattern. So it was easy to find every domain that they were registering against us or against other banks. But with GDPR, everything now is not accessible. So we need to find other way to find those domains against our company. LinkedIn, again, it sounds funny, but many people publish too many things on LinkedIn. And sometimes we find projects or new service that Desjardins is providing to our clients because someone's gonna say, hey, here's a new project, cool project that we have done. Here's the technology, here. So they give all the technologies that it is involved in one project. So it's good for the fraudster because they are able to find exactly what they would need to do against us. But also for us, it's good because it helps us to discover new technology that we were not aware of. So we contact again the project and say, hey, why did you contact us? But also the portal, the internal, the intranet, there is a lot of information also there. I know it's most of the time it's the first page in the morning, but many people only click at X and say, hey, I don't want to check the portal, but there's a lot of information also that you can find there that are very useful to connect to the, for example, the PIR. Okay, actionable. It's hard to do it manually, so with a tip, we can do the IOC ingestion, the indicator of compromise, and after that, we can connect to our SIM with a degree of confidence because, like I've mentioned, we receive millions of IOCs each and every weeks, months, whatever, so we cannot ingest everything into the SIM because the surveillance SIM will kill us. So we need to have a certain degree of confidence based on the source. So if we trust the source or the source is reliable, we can add a degree of confidence that is higher. So it will not generate false positive to the surveillance team. We're lucky enough because we are part of this team. So they don't run too much against us, and they have access to the tip to bypass some IOCs when they have done the investigation and they find that it's not useful. Automatization, we do a lot. Before I mentioned Shodan and the demand monitoring, there's a lot of stuff that we do. A few years ago, it was done manually, so it was a pain in to do it manually. But now with the automation, it's not big automation, machine learning, AI, whatever the buzzword. It's only Python script that we run. So at least it does the cleanup for us, and we only receive emails of what has been found based on keywords. So we receive emails. So all the domains that are registered in the world, there is a free stuff that you can. I think it's not Verizon, I don't remember the name, but there's a free database that you can download on the internet each and every morning. And after that, you can process all the domains that were registered. So it's very useful to have it. But for sure, you need to have the developer for you. But when you have it, you're really happy. And there are pre-filtering for communication. So all the information, the vast amount of information that we have, we can process it and only focus on the stuff that really it is really important based on our experience, because for sure we miss things, but when there's an incident or we miss something, we adjust our script and add those new keywords to the monitoring. Communication. There's for sure alerts. So I would not say we're submerged by alerts, but we see a lot of emails, but my life is my cell phone is there, but I cannot lose it because I'm going to be in trouble. We have also our portal, so a CTI portal. So we have access to many different information, but we're not in a two ticketing system like Archer, HPSM. I would say we don't like to follow rules. So we're a weird team, so we do live with our cell phone or an internet connection. So when they ask us to open a ticket and to follow to enter all the fields, sometimes it bugs us because the information that we receive sometimes is intangible. We receive a piece of information, but we are not sure. On their side, they want to have the IOCs, the IP, whatever the stuff, but we cannot give them information. We are only aware of something. We just want to publish the information. So that's why we have added our portal. So at least it is our own ticket. So we can connect directly via our cell phone to create a ticket or send an email to the mail drop database that will create the ticket automatically. So that's the kind of stuff that we have done to be faster because we are only three. The mobile app for executive, it's based on Power Apps. We're a big Microsoft shop. So it has been done by our DevOps teams. There are five people. They don't work for us mainly. It's mainly for the rest of the SOC, but they have developed the application. So it's based on our portal. They can connect to the portal and have access it to a Power App. So it's you can have all the information that you need and you can ask questions if you have any related to a publication that we have done. Also, the communication, we do monthly, weekly, and ad hoc documents. So all the security news, it's when you understand the news, it's for us, it's easy, but for our manager, sometimes it's complicated. So we need to do the assessment, and we do a publication. We try to be, down, I would say, to their level of understanding. We have also briefing. 4 days a week, we have briefing. So we talk to our personnel and to executive, and we also do roadshow. So we do presentation on what we do. So step we have done. Like mentioned earlier, know your own company, know your org chart, your crown jewels, share with partners, communication, and be passionate. Know your own company, mentioned earlier, go onto your website on your intranet. There's a lot of information for you, but for also sometimes the fraudster, there's sometimes too many information, but I encourage you to go check it. Even though it's, it's my company, yeah, I know it, no. Go check it. For sure, you're going to find something that you were not aware of. Marketing team are the best people to publish something without publishing it to anyone else. They want to be the first on the market, so they publish a lot of stuff. Know your R chart. Know who is who. So only take a sheet of paper and try to draw what you know about your company. Who's the boss of who? Who knows who? Who works with who? Who went to school with this person? So sometimes it can help us, or sometimes you can be careful when you say something to someone, or the way you're gonna say something to someone, depending on who's who in the company. So yeah, I know it's politics, but politics is part of it also. And know your crown jewels. We have done this job at Desjardins, so we're able to see what has value for a fraudster, but what has value also only for our reputation. It's not only to lose money, but if we lose our reputation, we're out of business. Like I mentioned, we're mainly in the province of Quebec, so if we lose the confidence of our clients, we're dead. So you should consider trying to find your crown jewels, your secret sauce. Share with partners. There's a couple of them. For us, the Government of Canada, Twitter, CCTX, Canadian Maker Association, HISAC, because we're in the insurance industry, so we receive information over there, FSISAC, RCMP, and Twitter and mailing list, so there's a website. So there's a lot of information that you can have. The communication that I mentioned earlier, here's some example at your right. It's the Power App, so you can have a color code, so based on the color, they can share the information or they can talk about this because sometimes we receive information that is confidential. So we don't want them to leak the information and it's built on trust. So when we receive information from our friends, we don't want them to be upset against us if something's went out of Desjardins because of us or in the news. So there's a weekly in the middle. So it's in French, but actualité de la dernière semaine. And at the far left, it's a PDF, so it goes up to our CEO. So each month you receive this document. So it's a two-pager. It is done by my team. So one of my team members the artist, I would say. So he loves all the IMAX stuff and video. So we have done videos, and people understand with image. So we try to be very imaginative when on what we do. And I, like I mentioned, be passionate. It's the, you need it. You cannot have people that don't want to work or want to work only 35 hours a week. It's, I would say it's impossible. So you need to don't count your hours and work like, I wouldn't say like crazy, but I would say like crazy. Apply what we have learned today. So my suggestion, if you don't have anything yet, or probably you have something, but I think it would be useful to do an internal personal assessment. So like I mentioned, browse your company website, social media, LinkedIn, and Instagram. There's a lot of stuff on Instagram. It's funny. So it's worth it to go check over there, because many people post too many things about your company. It's really funny. Each and every week we find things and we contact the person and say, hey, remove this. Identify all the sector of activities of your company. It depends the size of your company, but you need to be aware of everything and the interaction. And my suggestion also, identify 10 partners, clients and provider. Probably you know the main one, but is there some that you need to be much more closer to them? So we try to also to know them and to understand them, so you will have a better relationship with them. Know your org chart. See, like I mentioned, CISO, executive, IT, SOC, business units, if applicable. Try to take a sheet of paper, only in nothing formal, but at least to have the thinking about it. Know your crown jewels. What has value for you? What is the greatest risk? Like I mentioned, it's not only to lose money, but you can lose your reputation or your secret sauce. So you can try to identify it, because you know your company better than anyone else. First 3 months. In theory, you should have a clearer view of your company and subsidiaries. High level, who's who. You identify the name, but after that, try to find the relationship between the people. So it can help you, and try to make friends with them. It sounds funny, but you need to have friends. it sounds funny, but you need to have friends in life, but in your job also, you need to have friends. Try to create 3 PIR concerning your company. So to try to focus, because there are so many information, so you need to try to focus on exactly what you should focus on. 3 is, I would say, is the minimum. We have more than 12, but it's because we cover so large. We, based on the documentation of a CTI team, we don't do CTI. We do CTI with IOCs, but we are deeply, deeply involved in the fraud department. It's more than 60% of our time is spent on trying to find the fraudster, because of the online banking and the SWIFT stuff. They are very aggressive, and we lose money. So my main goal is sponge them in the face and to get them arrested, and it works. So we try to get to have them, cost of doing business, we want them to have it a very high level of cost of doing business against Desjardins. Within 6 months, set up a cyber threat intelligent practice, role and responsibilities. Sometimes it's hard to do it, because you do your jobs of information, but you have access to so many information. Sometimes it's frustrating for the other team, because they feel challenged, and that you don't trust them to do their job well. But sometimes it's difficult to trace the line between the role and responsibilities. Acquire different sources of information related to your PRR. I mentioned OSN at first, so don't buy everything on the internet, because it does not worth it. Begin by doing it by yourself and try to know the information. Organize and sort threat information, even a spreadsheet. It's better than nothing. I know that the spreadsheet is supposed to be dead, but it's better than nothing. Distribute threat intelligence internally by email at first. Eventually, probably via a portal and stuff like that on Power Apps, but at least by email. I still have my mailing list, and it works. So wherever you are, you can have access to your information. No need to connect to your infrastructure. Consume threat intelligence in your monitoring tool. If you are able to do the automation, for sure it's going to be easier to do it, because when it's done automatically, you can focus on something else, because the bad guys are really good to be imaginative. So, are we successful? incident. From reactivity to proactivity, I think our program is successful. It's been there for more than 4 to 5 years officially. The external audit, we were audited by IBM in 2015 and by Mandiant in 2018. And the CTI department was the, since the last 5 years, five years, we're the best team. We are the out of five, I think we're at four. So it's for sure we're not at five, and I think we don't want to be at five because it's too formal, but at least we're able to reproduce each and every time. It's mainly the kind of stuff that we need to be very square on what we do. So I think the external audit proves that we're, our CTI program is successful. The involvement in projects, question from business unit, we are advised now. So people contact us and ask CTI team, hey, are you aware of, here's a new project. I was not sure if you were aware, but here's a quick recap of our project, or you're invited. We were gonna do a presentation about the kick of the project. So at least we don't want to interfere in their project, but at least we're informed because information is everything for us. So we need to have access to this kind of stuff. So now it's fun because it's them that contact us. Invitation to various forums. So internally, externally, and a C-level committee. So we were, like I mentioned, Desjardins have many subsidiaries. So they have all their C-level panel. And we were invited on each of them to talk about the security. So, and we had questions. And the 20 minutes that we were supposed to have was more than an hour in each time because they were asking us questions. So they were curious. So we were happy to have done our job because now they talk security for us. It's not only a geek thing. So was it easier to be in the security fields 5 years ago? Yes, from my point of view, it was easier because game has changed. The cloud, the way of doing the hack and the planet is small. So yes, thing has changed, but I think it's possible to do something about it and to be able to take control of your security with a CTI team. So that's my, that was my slide. Any question? Okay, thank you. Oh, yeah, question, yes. Okay.
So you talked about the reactive and proactive incident response.
Yep.
Can you just give us one example of your proactive?
Okay. Response? Yep. The reactive one, for example, 5 years ago, one of our website, external website, was hacked, but the website was not monitored via our SIM, and we were contacted by an external parties from Europe. We were targeting their clients, but they were using our website to compromise their clients. So it was a panic because we were contacted by someone external to Canada. We were serving malware to others around the world. So it was reactivity. Now, what we're trying to, their security now, there's no excuse because we have had a security incident in the past few months. And some of them were pretty bad, but we were able to mitigate it. For sure, a bad guy will always be successful, but we try to be faster than them and to mitigate the issue. Now, when we ask something to the IT team or project, they need to sign the bottom line. If they don't want to do it, it's gonna be escalated to the upper management because the CISO now wants to know it. Just an example, our pen testing team have tools to scan all the network drives. And when they find things, they think like a bad guy, like a red team, because we have a red team practice. When they find things, for example, credentials or a database that is put there for a test purpose, the person will get a notification, the boss will get a notification, and the CISO will get a notification that the person has leaked something. So now we try to be more proactive on, we want people to be aware by themselves that security is important. So that's the kind of the thing has changed, that we try to let them think about security, but to assume the risk also, and they don't want to receive an email that we stand for in this situation. So we try to focus differently on how we do security. So to raise awareness. So we touch a lot of stuff. Too many probably, but it's fun. Other questions? Nope. Thank you.